Your mercy is wide, 'cause you're good. take your time this morning, hallelujah. Thank you. Thank you, Father God. Father, we love you. Oh, Father, we praise you. Oh, Father, we worship you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Father God. Praise you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. And we know that he's always with us, church. He's never going to leave us, church, or forsake us. Oh, yes. I believe you gave sight to the blind. I believe that the dead came to life. I believe there are wonders inside. You're still the same. I believe every word that you said. I believe there are scars in your head. That your goodness is good without end. You'll never change. I will tell of your wonders, sing of your grace. The God of creation knows me by name. The Lord.
Hallelujah.
Take your time, church. Take your time this morning. Yes, Father. We hold on to your promise, oh God. Oh, Father, we know, God, that there's battles in life, oh Lord. Oh, Father, but the battle is yours. The battle is yours, Father God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, praise you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Father God. Oh, come on, church. We know the battle is his in the name of Jesus. Come on. Even when we look, church, all around. When it looks like I'm surrounded by the enemy, and it feels like hope is far beyond my reach, I know the battle, I know the battle, I know the battle, the battle is yours. I know the battle, I know the battle. The battle's yours, God, and you're with us, oh Jesus. Oh, come on, church, let's sing it out. When the seas agree that they should rage against me, and the storm it pours its wrath upon my head, there's a name that's sure to save us, never fail.
The battle is yours, always.
you, Lord. At this time, church, we're going to take our prayer request before God. So at this time, even as we read off the written prayer request, amen, you can go ahead and have a seat if you like, or you can continue to stand. It's completely up to you. But as I read off these prayers, amen, let's begin to pray for each and every one of them, amen, and believe. Let's believe, church. Let's believe together, amen. And it's also right after we do this, amen, we want to take your needs before God. And at that time, we'll have you all stand, and then we'll go ahead and take our needs before the Lord, amen, by simply lifting of our hand and lifting of our voice, amen, because God wants to hear from us, church. He does. There's power in words. There is. There's power in words, amen. And today, I want to encourage you, amen, to go ahead and exercise, amen, that power in the name of Jesus. So this morning, let's go ahead and believe God this morning, amen. These prayer requests are for salvation. Some are for healing. Some for strength, financial needs, amen. There's some families, amen, some people that are mourning the loss of loved ones, amen. So let's pray for them for comfort. And then there's other needs, amen. There's so many different needs, amen, that we have in our lives, amen. So let's pray and believe God for that, for the Melendez family. Heavenly Father, this morning, God, we come before you, Lord. And we're going to believe you, Father God Almighty, for the Melendez family, Father God. We pray for them, Lord, and Chris Melendez, Father. And also, Father, Brother Jay and Sister Yvette. Lord, that we pray for healing, God, as they're both sick. Lord God, touch in the name of Jesus. We lift up Brenda Scott this morning and Cynthia the driver and Tony Flores, God. Neil Ishman, Lord, touch, oh God. Nelson Hernandez and Ed Sloan. We pray for Maria Maronado, Father God, and Marta Kelly, Lord, and Deborah Maronado and Sylvia Valdez. And let's pray for Ada Flamali this morning, the Martinez children, and Luis Morales Jr., Javier Peterson Jr. and the Rodriguez children. Father, we lift up Jerry Rodriguez this morning, God, for a touch, oh Lord. Brother Emilio, Father God, and Scott Manish, Lord. We also pray, Father, for Rich Ramirez, Lord God. We lift up, Father, Brother Robert, Lord, and little Gio and their family, Father God. We continue to pray for them, Lord. We also pray for Christina this morning, Father God, and John and Desiree Alexander, Lord. And we lift up Juan and Jessica Rodriguez, Lord, and Angelica Algazar and children, and Melly Martinez and children. Geraldo, Michelle Rodriguez, and Mike Pena, Father God, and Ray Cuevas, Lord. We lift up Eddie Solorio, Father God. We also pray, Lord God, amen, for Evie, Father God. That's Nani's niece, Lord. You know the need, Father God. We pray for healing in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. We also prayed this morning, Father God Almighty, for Dominique, Lord. We continue, Lord, to pray for her, Lord. Lord, we lift up our brother Eric, Lord, and our sister Stephanie, Father God. We pray, Father, for our brother Emilio, Lord, that you may just continue to touch him, Father, for healing, God. Patty, Lord, for healing from surgery, Lord. Malik, amen, from Crohn's disease, Father God. Touch, Lord God. We continue to pray for Brother Chino and Sister Martha and the whole Fisiliano family, God. Alex Corpus, Lord, and Pete and Shirley in Arizona. Jordan in Florida, God. We also pray for Renee Lugo, Lord, and Andy in Texas, and Anthony, God. We lift up the Lugo family, Lord God. We also pray for Teresa this morning, Lord. Also, Father God Almighty, we pray, Father, for Carlos and Yvonne and Jose and Christina. Victoria, Josiah, Elijah, and Isaac, and Quentin, and amen. God, you know who these are, Lord God. Alex and Emily, and Jesse, Becca, and Jay, and Gloria Mendoza, and Richie Caravales, amen. And Isaiah, Lord, we pray for little Isaiah, Father God. Camarillo, Lord, that you may continue to touch, oh God. The Cuevas family, Lord, the Campos family, the Camarillo family, God, and we lift up our sister Cassandra, her daughter Valise, Lord God, our sister Maribel, Lord, and we also pray for sister Nina, God. We pray, Father, for all the grandchildren, Lord. We pray for all the grandchildren. We pray for all the grandchildren, the great-grandchildren. We pray for the children, God. We pray for every parent, Lord, every husband, every wife, God. We lift up Carmen Ramos, Father, Emily, and Inami, Lord God. We also pray for Ralphie this morning, Lord. And Father, we pray, Lord, for all the pastors, Father God. We lift up, Lord, the church in Whiting, Father God. We pray for them, Lord God. We lift up the Cal City Church, and we lift up the Nashville Church, Father God. We pray for them, Lord, that you continue, Lord, to move in a mighty way, Father God, for all of them, Father. We also pray, Father God, for all the churches in California, Lord, all the churches in California and all our partners with New Destiny Ministries, the City of Life, and all those other churches that are partnering up with us, Father God. We thank you, Lord, Father. And this morning, Lord, we're also going to pray, Lord, for the Middle East, Father God, for right now, Lord, the tensions are high, God. And we know, Lord, what your word says, Lord, involving Israel, Father God. And with that attack with Iran, Father, we know, God, amen, that the signs are just lining up, Lord. And we pray, Father, we pray, God, that you may just keep your hand upon the world, Lord. We pray for all the soldiers, Lord, the military, God, all the innocent, Lord God. And we pray, Father God Almighty, that we all stand in the gap, Lord, lifting up your kingdom, Father God, because it's your kingdom that's going to make a difference, Lord, in the name of Jesus. And we could all stand this morning, church, amen. Let's all stand together in one mind and one accord, church, and let's go ahead and believe God together. We're going to go ahead and give him a hand of praise, and then once again, you lift up your hand, you lift up your voices, but let's go ahead and give him thanks this morning. Let's thank him, amen. Yes, Father God, we thank you. Yes, Father God, we praise you. Yes, Father God, we worship you, Lord. Oh, Father, you are worthy. Oh, Father, you are awesome. Oh, Father, you are amazing, Jesus. Oh, right now, Lord, we pray, Father, for every written prayer request, Lord God. And right now, we lift up our hands, Lord, and we stand in the gap, Father God. Oh, come on, church, you begin to pray. You begin to lift up the knees. Oh, Father, right now, Lord, I want to lift up, Father God, our brother PRT, Father God, that you may continue, Lord, to touch, Lord, and heal, God. Heal him from that sickness, Lord God. Oh, Father, as he battles through it, Lord, we pray for healing, God, for all those that are sick, my Lord. I pray, Father God, this morning, Lord God, Lord, for all those, God, battling, Lord God, Lord, in the name of Jesus, Father. That we find rest in you, God. That we keep our eyes fixed on you, Lord. Oh, Father, we pray, God Almighty. Lord, for salvation. We pray for healings. We pray for doors to open, God. Oh, Father, I want to pray, God, for all those out there in the outreach yesterday, God, all those that were spoken to, Lord, all those that were invited, every flyer that's been circulating, Lord, we pray, God, draw souls to you, Lord. Draw them to you, God. Build your kingdom, Lord, in the mighty, mighty name of Jesus. Come on, church, let's praise him this morning. Let's worship the Lord this morning. Thank you, Father. We worship you, Jesus. Thank you, Father God. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen and amen. Well, let's go ahead and get out of our seats, church. Amen. Let somebody know, amen, that God is going to move. Hallelujah. All right, as we get back to our seats, amen. As we get back to our seats, we do have some announcements for you here this morning, amen. But let's go ahead at this time, welcome out all those online with us. Thank you so much, amen, for those online. We appreciate you being with us, amen. Thank you so, so much, amen. Hallelujah. Well, praise God. Amen. We have some announcements for you. First of all, I want to go ahead and give a thanks, amen, to the street team that came out yesterday. Amen. Thank you so much for coming out. It was such a beautiful, beautiful day yesterday. Amen. It was such a gorgeous day. And I'm glad that we were out and about. Amen. We spoke to several people. Amen. And invite them out. And let's just believe God for them. Amen. In the name of Jesus, let's keep them in our prayers. Hallelujah. And then remember that today is Sunday. So there is classrooms. Once we get ready right before the preaching, we'll put it on the screen. But there's nursery today, amen, newborns to the age of 4. There's also, amen, going to be kingdom kids, which is ages 5 to 7. And also the Light It Up for Jesus, ages 8 through 12, amen. And if you're new here and you got kids, amen, during prayer, once prayer's over, they do have at the kitchen window somebody checking in the children, amen. So you can check them in at that time. But if you get here during the service, you can check them in when you walk them to the classroom, parents. You got to walk them to the nursery, the kingdom kids, amen, and check them in. Hallelujah. And then check them out, amen. Don't leave them back there. Hallelujah. We would love to keep them, but you got to check them out. Amen. In the name of Jesus. So, hallelujah, that is that. Amen. Remember, during the week, there is prayer. Amen. In the mornings, there's prayer in the mornings right here in the fellowship hall from 6 in the morning to 7 in the morning. And then also prayer on Saturday mornings at 8 to 9 a.m. And then, of course, amen, we have our weekday services. Amen. We're right here Tuesdays and Friday nights. So come on back. Come join us, amen, 6:30 for prayer and 7:30 for service in the name of Jesus. And, of course, amen, Wednesdays is also corporate prayer, amen. That's from 6 to 7 p.m. And then Thursdays is the group Bible study, amen, from 7 to 8 p.m., except for the first Thursday of the month. But on the first Thursday of the month, you do have the new converts class, amen. So every first Thursday of the month, there's a new converts class at 7 p.m. right here in the fellowship hall. And remember, anything that's taking place in the fellowship hall, use the side door, amen, right here on Henry Street. There is a doorbell in case the door is closed, amen. Amen. Well, let's get into what's coming up. Amen. Well, first thing coming up on Friday. Amen. There is a snack shop on Friday night. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. This is after service. After service. Amen. In the fellowship hall, you'll be able to partake. Amen. Of the menu item of Nacho Supremes, hot dogs and cheeseburgers and chili cheese dogs, amen. So that'll be Friday, amen, for Snack Shop right through these doors. So make sure you have what you need, amen, in order to take care of that, amen. Be blessed. And remember that the funds for the Snack Shop is not for the church, amen. No, that is strictly for, it has its purpose, amen, outside of the church, amen. The church is supported by us, amen, giving in our tithes and our offering. So remember, that is for a special cause. So go ahead, amen. If you need to know what the special cause is, you talk to Brother Oscar, amen. And there's also a sign-up list on the table. It may be filled already, but check it out. They might need some help for the snack shop on Friday night. And then, amen, next week there is a revival that we're invited to. Praise God. Amen. Pastor Alex Aceto is coming down. Amen. He's also bringing his wife. Amen, Sister Lorena. So we're going to be tremendously blessed. But they're going to start the revival in Cal City. So we're invited that Wednesday, amen, April the 24th. We're going to be invited, amen, to go back them up in Cal City. And that's at 6:30 for prayer, 7:30 for service. And then on Thursday night, they're going to be at the Whiting Church. Now that is 6 o'clock prayer, 7 o'clock service at Whiting. Amen. So he'll be over there. So once again, that Wednesday, Thursday, nothing going on here. You're welcome to go back it up. Amen. But Friday night, he'll be right here with us. Amen. They'll be here that 26th of April. Amen. 6:30 for prayer, 7:30 for service right here. And also Sunday morning, April the 28th. Amen. We're going to be blessed with two extra days right here, amen, for the revival. So if you want to take part of it all, praise God. If you want to take part of some of it, praise God. But bring somebody with you, amen. And you just never know, that could be the message that they need to hear and be touched. Hallelujah. He's also going to do the men's discipleship class. So guys, he's going to do the men's class, amen. That's going to be Saturday, April the 27th, 9 a.m. prayer, 10 o'clock teaching. That will be at the El Centro, at the Whiting Church, amen. That'll be at the Whiting Church, amen. Since I'm talking about the men, for the ladies, I forgot, amen, to say thank you for those that came out to the Shape Up teaching yesterday, amen. I believe the attendance was around 24, amen. So praise God, amen. Thank you for backing it up, amen. And I hope you were blessed, hallelujah, with that. Hallelujah. What else is coming up after that? Amen. Oh, we have a one-night revival, amen. May 1st, that's going to be with Pastor Jeff Marshall. He's from Australia, amen. Pastor Jeff Marshall, he's from Australia. Amen. So we're going to be tremendously blessed. He's going to be at the Cal City Church on May 1st. That's a Wednesday. And then he's also going to be at the Whiting Church on that Thursday, May 2nd. Amen. So you got 2 dates. Amen. Right? And that's it. Amen. So we have an opportunity to back them up that Wednesday, May 1st at Cal City, or Thursday, May 2nd in Whiting. This is Pastor Jeff Marshall from Australia. Amen. So come on down. Let's back it up in the name of Jesus. Let's find out what's going on down under. Amen. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise God. What else is coming up? Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. Well, we do have our conference. Amen. Established Foundation. Hallelujah. And that's what we are, amen. We got to establish, we have an established foundation that we got to keep. Hallelujah. Remember that it involves evangelism, discipleship, church planting, and that's going to be in the month of June. Amen. We have a great lineup, amen, for the conference. So be excited, amen. This is our conference. We're the ones, amen. We're the mother church here. We're the ones, this is our conference that we're putting together, amen. Not Pastor Gene, not myself, or Pastor Ruben. We are putting this together because this is our conference, amen. We are the host, amen. So let's get ready for that. Once again, starts on Tuesday night, so there's going to be special music. There's going to be reports. There's going to be a powerful word each night, amen, from Tuesday to Friday night. And then on Thursday and Friday, we do have our morning sessions, which prayer starts at 8 in the morning, and the teaching start right at 9 o'clock. So 9 o'clock, one teaching, 9:46, the second teaching. We have a nice continental breakfast, and then we have the third teaching around 11-ish, and we pretty much end by 12 noon for the morning sessions. So once again, let's take part of that. I believe there's also, amen, two clipboards, one to see how many are attending the morning services. So check it out. You plan on attending, put your name down. And then if you also, amen, if there's, if you need help, amen, if they need help for the hospitality, if you're available to help, go ahead and put your name down, and there's more information for you. And praise God, I just got a note. A wire came down. Amen. Please announce Pastor Alex's wife, Sister Lorena, will teach a women's class. Woo! The same date as the men. Yes, hallelujah. So the April 27th, amen, I think it's 27th, there's going to be a women's teaching, amen, by Sister Lorena, amen. So let's be blessed with that. As far as the time, we'll, same time as ours. Well, praise God, same time as ours. So 9 o'clock prayer, 10 o'clock teaching, and that will be here for the women's teaching here, and the men will be over there. Amen? So parents, split your kids. Got multiple kids? Okay, mama, you take this one. You got to take that one. I'll go ahead and take this one over here. Oh, no, you're going to take this one. Just figure it out, and, or get a babysitter. Praise the Lord.
Amen. Well, we're going to be blessed with that. Amen. And then, of course, amen, we've been announcing the Nash Invasion. The Nash Invasion. August the 31st. Amen. And amen. This is our baby church and that we have out there in Nashville. Pastor Dean and Sister Francis, they've already started their services. Amen. Amen. So we're going to go back them up. Amen. This is going to be labor, church. We're going to labor. We're not going to fellowship and party and take a vacation. We are going to labor. We're going to meet at his church right at 10 a.m. Amen. And he's already going to have the assigned areas and the task, amen, that we're going to be doing. We're going to be doing a lot of labor, a lot of footwork, a lot of passing out flyers, a lot of witnessing. We're going to give testimonies, amen. We're going to have a prayer tent. We're going to do some street preachings on the corner, amen. Some of you are probably going to be arrested, amen. We'll praise God all for his honor and glory. Hallelujah. Hey, it happens sometimes. It never happened to us. God's given us favor, amen. I mean, we've been shut down, amen. But hey, we're living in those days, church. We're living in those days, amen. So, but the point is, amen. Get ready to labor, hallelujah, hallelujah. You know, it's gonna be a blessing. I'm sure there will be time after the outreach is over that late afternoon Saturday, because it's gonna be an all day event. Amen, that we'll be able to fellowship, but that's not the point of going. Amen. And once again, we do have a service to run here, and Pastor Gene's been going around to secure a core group, because we need a core group in order for this church to run. Amen. So, and praise God. If you're not going, back it up here. We need your backup here, church. Amen. So if you can do that. And those that are going, amen, make sure that let us know. Let me know, amen, because I do need to provide that information to Pastor Dean so that he could put the schedule together and assignments, amen. We don't want to just show up and then he's got to figure things out because nobody said that you're going and all of a sudden you're there, amen. So I have a list. Those that have been telling me, I've been putting them down. Make sure you see me write it down. If you didn't see me write it down, it's not written down, so you got to tell me again, amen. Hey, in the name of Jesus. Because sometimes they just come by. Hey, okay. Now, send me a text. Talk to me. I got my folder. Write it down. And I got you covered. All right? Praise God. Then remember, amen, there's also a Paris opportunity. And we do have some folks going, amen. Paris mission trip, September 16th through the 25th. Once again, see Sister Vanessa for the details. The details. What are some of the details? Amen. I don't know, but the details you should know. What time, what date are people arriving? Where are they arriving? Amen. Where are we going to meet up? When are we going to meet up? That's what I want to know if I'm going. Amen. I'm actually going to show up and it's like, what do I do now? Amen. Remember, you're going to Paris. They don't use the same electricity that we do. You need a plug if you want to plug in your phone and keep it charged, amen. You have to figure that out. Don't run out of power when you arrive there, and now you're trying, oh, now my thing's dead. How am I going to charge this? Figure that out. I bought something to charge my phone so I can have it because I know I need my phone. So make sure, be wise, amen, be wise. And I think that's it. Praise God. I think that's enough for today. So let's go ahead and give the Lord a big hand of praise as the ushers come forward. Come on, church. We're going to have a great time this morning.
Praise the Lord. Come on, praise him. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. How many know a lot of stuff is going on in our house of God? Hallelujah. How many are grateful to be part of that? I can't wait to hear the news, you know, what's taking place out there with Pastor Dean and Sister Francis, when brothers and sisters come back, and then, of course, the other places that we're going to, man, it's going to be a blessing. If you have your Bibles, please, I'm going to move to the book of Matthew chapter 6, and we're going to read a famous prayer, Matthew 6, verse 9 to 13. How many know prayer really works? Amen. Prayer moves the hand of God. And if you're not in prayer, you need to practice. You need to pray, because God hears your prayers. Don't let the devil lie to you and tell you that he doesn't hear you. He hears every single prayer. I have a little illustration. This is by Billy Graham. He once noted this. The title of this is Prayer is the Rope. Prayer is not about using God. It's more often about getting us in a position where God can use us. I watched the deck hands, he says, on a great liner, United States, as they docked the ship in New York Harbor. First, they threw out the rope to the men on the dock. Then inside the boat, the great motors went to work and pulled the great cable. But oddly enough, the pier wasn't pulled out of shape, up to the ship. The ship was pulled snuggling up to the pier. Church, prayer is a rope that pulls God and us together. But it doesn't pull God down to us. It pulls us to God. We must learn to say with Christ, the master of the art of praying, not my will, but thy will be done. Matthew 6, 9 through 13 begins to read, after this manner, therefore, pray ye, our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, very important here, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Verse 13. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. So here he says, let thy will be done. And he's telling his disciples this very thing because it's so important, because us as the disciples, children of God, followers of God, we have to follow what his will be done. Are you with me? How many know it's not our will anymore to live, but his will? It is his will for us to do outreaches. It is his will for us to reach the world. It is his will that we launch out churches. Are you with me today? So let us do what God calls us to do. Let his will be done in our lives. Every morning when you get up, ask God, let your will be done, God. And I'll tell you what, the Holy Spirit will guide you and lead you. Are you with me? Trust him today. Brother Bob, can you help us out? Let's sing that song, I've Been Delivered. How many been delivered here? Hallelujah. Let's sing it out. Been delivered, praise the Lord. I've been delivered by his blood. When I was bound by the chains of Satan, I've been delivered, praise the Lord. One more time. I've been delivered, praise the Lord. You sound good. I've been delivered by his blood. When I was bound by the chains of Satan, I've been delivered, praise the Lord. Let's give the Lord a praise cap offering today. Come on, praise him. He is so worthy to be praised. Have your way, my God. Have your way, Lord.
Glory, 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 glory. God is good this morning. I said God is good this morning. He's an awesome God. Let me make sure. I guess this is my water right here, right? Praise the Lord. And I like that Pastor Victor mentioned that we're still going to have church over here when we go to Nashville. So we'll still have the church running. So you come and back up your church. But I think this is our first time actually going on a mission trip to help one of our churches. First time. So you learn different things when you first do something. And I for the next one, because I know we're going to be going back to help out Pastor Dean again, and we plan to plant more churches in different states. So there's going to be a common occurrence for us. So letting Pastor Victor know that I think what we need to kind of put in place is for the next one, not this one, for the next one, we just need to fly. You'll have months in advance to get your tickets. And some of you got cheap tickets because they get cheap. As low as $39 one way. So that's what we'll do. The next time we go to go help out one of our churches, we'll give you a few months advance notice. And then you set up your travel to fly in and let's get back home. Because we have a ministry to run here. Amen? So we'll do that for the next one. And thank God for those that are staying behind, you know, to keep the church open. And then those that go, let's be ready to labor for the kingdom. And again, I like what Pastor Victor said. I didn't tell him to say all that. But see, he knows that. He knows we're not going over to go see Paula Deen's restaurant. Amen. We're going there to labor for the kingdom of Christ. Now, if you go there early and you want to go do those things, be blessed. But on Saturday is the outreach. Don't say, I'm going to go to Memphis. I want to go see Elvis Presley. Then you go on a different day. Amen. You know, you go fly out there. But Saturday is strictly for the church until he dismisses us and he tells us we're all done. Then the rest of the night, whatever, be blessed. You can go wherever you want. Okay? Is that fair enough? Because I know when you go different places, you want to see some parts of the city, don't you? And Nashville is really a nice, nice city to visit. It really is. And I believe we'd have a good time. Also with the women's class, women's special service, whatever we want to call it. It's just a service for the ladies. This just came out because he's bringing his wife. So we want to take advantage of Sister Lorena. She has a lot of experience. Again, and her husband, Pastor Alex, they've planted churches. They've been overseas. She's done women's classes overseas. So it's good to take advantage of that type of experience while they're here. Amen? So let's take advantage of that. Glory to God. Glory. All right, let's turn your Bibles to the book of Matthew, chapter 25. And we're going to look at verses 14 through 30. Give me a good amen when you are there. We'll read it in a few here. I'll let you know when we'll start reading it. And I want to minister a message, entitled, The Talents Given by Christ. The Talents Given by Christ. Hallelujah. Let's pray together. Father, I ask you, God, that your anointing will accompany me in this place. I pray, God, that I decrease and you increase. Lord, that you receive all the honor and all the glory. I want to thank all those that are here today and all those that are watching us on live stream, and that you minister to every individual that is here. And in the mighty name of Jesus, we pray, and the church says, amen and amen. The talents, understanding the talents given by Christ, amen. In Matthew chapter 25, verses 14 through 30, and we'll read those in a second. In that chapter, there are two parables. And we know parables were given by Jesus, little stories to bring spiritual understanding. So in these two parables, the first one is, of course, the wise and the foolish virgins. We know about that one. But then he goes on to talk about a parable in about the talents. And both these parables talk about the Lord's return. But there is a difference, a key difference between these two parables, the wise and foolish virgins and the talents. And the difference is the wise and the foolish virgins, that parable was stressing being prepared. Amen? Preparation, being prepared for the coming of the Lord. But then in the latter part of the second parable, this is talking about being productive. So the first parable talks about being prepared as a person, but the second one on the talents, it is speaking about productivity, being a productive person. Now, one other common denominator between these two parables is that they both emphasize watching for the Lord. And they both emphasize working for the Lord. So, as we learn through both parables that we have to, of course, be waiting on the coming of the Lord. And it's getting close. No one This is just a little free tidbit for you. No one knows when Jesus is coming back. I don't care what those people say on the radio, on TV, you know, during the eclipse, some people thought, no. No one knows when Jesus is coming back. But he does give us the signs of his coming. And right now, the signs are there that the rapture of the church is getting near. It's getting very, very close. And what you want to do is, if you're into end days prophecy and last days scriptures, you have to really stay focused on what's taking place in the Middle East, okay? So a lot of things that have already happened that line up with the Word of God, but everything is centered right there. Not the United States, everything's centered in biblical prophecy in the Middle East, okay? So we know that Jesus is coming back. We just don't know when he's going to come back. So while we wait on the coming of the Lord, in the parable, God wants us to be productive. Now let's take a look at the verses, and then you can see what I'm talking about. Let's read it. For the kingdom of heaven is like a man traveling to a far country who called his own servants and delivered his goods to them. And to one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, and to another 1, to each according to his own ability. And immediately he went on a journey. Verse 16. Then he who received 5 talents went and traded with them and made another 5 talents. And likewise, he who received 2 gained 2 more also. But look at the last person. But he who received 1 went and dug in the ground and hid his Lord's money. After a long time, the Lord of those servants came and settled the accounts with them. So he who had received 5 talents came and brought 5 other talents, saying, Lord, you delivered me 5 talents. Look, I have gained 5 more talents besides these. His Lord said to him, well done, good and faithful servant. You were faithful over a few things. I will make you a ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of the Lord. He also who had received 2 talents came and said, Lord, you delivered me 2 talents. Look, I have gained 2 more talents besides these. And his Lord said to him, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of the Lord. Then he who received the 1 talent came and said, Lord, I knew you would be a hard man, reaping where you have not sown and gathering where you have not scattered seed. And I was afraid. And I went and hid your talent in the ground. Look, there you have what is yours. But look how God responds in verse 26. But his Lord answered and said to him, you wicked and lazy servant. You knew that I reap where I have not sown, gather where I have not scattered seed. So you ought to have deposited my money with the bankers, and at my coming, I would have received back my own interest. So take the talent from him and give it to him who has 10 talents. For to everyone who has, more will be given, and he will have an abundance. But from the one who does not have, even what he has will be taken away. But look at the scary part, verse 30. And cast that unprofitable servant into outer darkness. And there'll be weeping and gnashing of teeth. So the Bible shows us in verse 14 and 15 that for the kingdom of heaven is like a man traveling into a far country. And he called his servants and gave them their goods. So we see here that he calls the servants together and he begins to disperse these talents. The talents here are monetary. They represent money. So this talent is a monetary measure. And it amounted to 6,000 denarios. So to accumulate 6,000 denarios, it will take an ordinary laborer back then 20 years to earn 6,000 denarios. So here, the talents are given to each according to his ability. So he has these servants, and he gives them this denaro, and he says, I'm going to give you this much. And then the next guy, he gives them so much. And then in the third guy, he gives so much. So he's giving them just enough to deal with. So the story goes on. And we find out that after a while, the Lord returns. His Lord returns after a long time. And then the first two servants, what did they do? The Bible says that they took what they had and they doubled their amount. They were productive. Amen? They stood before their Lord with excitement. And the scripture says, behold. So that means that they were looking excited to see the Lord. When they say behold, they're ready. They were happy. And their Lord praises their work, saying, well done. And he even commends them both. And he calls them a good, faithful servant. And he rewards them by promoting them. And he tells them, you were faithful over a few things. I will make you a ruler over many things. See, this is something that you and I must understand as Christians, that God, now, we're not talking about, in this particular parable, it's monetary to use the measurement, but we know that God is talking about productivity. Because the last guy he gave the talent to, how many know he wasn't productive? See, whatever God has measured and given you, God wants to see productivity in your life. Whatever he's depositing in you, the Lord wants us to produce, say amen, someone. And see, when you have what you have and you give to the Lord and you do what you're supposed to do, how many know that God will reward you for it? The Bible says that the first two guys, they doubled it, and the Lord was happy. Their Lord was happy with that. Matter of fact, he even rewards them. He tells them, enter into the joy of the Lord. But see, the last guy represents a lot of people in church sometimes. One thing that people have in church of not being productive in their relationship with God is they have a lot of excuses for it. Say amen, someone. Because it's funny that we can get excited for other things in life. There's nothing wrong with enjoying life. But sometimes that's all we're focused on is enjoying life. We're not understanding that God has given you some precious things. God has deposited in you things in your life that God wants you to use to produce and bring others with you to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, to begin to produce in your life and in the church. So we see that these two other servants, their Lord rewards them because they were productive. But the third guy listens to how the Lord characterizes him. Now, he thought he was going to get away with some things. So what he did was, right when his Lord gave him the talents, like me, I'm the Lord, and I'm giving Jerry his one talent. So here you go. Immediately what he did, because the Bible says the Lord left. He took off. He had to go do what he had to go do. He didn't come back for a long time. In that duration of that time, guess what the one guy does? He takes his talent, and he decides, I ain't going to do nothing with this. So I'm going to take it and bury it. So what he was saying is that what God gave him, he did not understand the value of it. Oh, help me, Holy Ghost. See, we don't understand the value of what God has given to you in your life. So the Lord comes back and tells him, you wicked servant, and you were lazy. And then the Bible says this, that the servant knew the character of his Lord. Because doesn't the one servant say, Lord, I knew that you were a hard man. He knows the Lord. He knows how his Lord is. But yet, even having knowledge of who his Lord was, he still went and put it in the ground. It's like people in church, you know that Jesus is coming back. You know that God is real. You know that God exists. You know that Jesus is real. But yet they refuse to get right with God.
The very thing, this thing is so valuable in your life. Salvation is priceless. The very thing, once you get saved, you understand this is so precious. How can we take what God has given us and decide not to produce more, but take it and just bury it? Hello. He even tells them, hey, you can at least went and deposit the money in the bank. And at least he could have got interest from it. But see, he doesn't take it to the bank because he did not value its value. So he decides, I'll just bury it and leave it there. But literally, he knows that the Lord came back. See, right now in the church, and when I speak about the church, I'm speaking more than just us here. Amen? The body of Christ, the church of the living God, we're in a waiting period right now. We've been in a waiting period since the resurrection of Jesus Christ. What are we waiting for? We're waiting for the return of our Lord. He is coming back. He's not coming back for the Protestant, the Pentecostal, the Baptist, the Lutheran. No, he's coming back for a people without spot, blemish, or wrinkle. That's what he's coming back for. So the question is going to be, beloved, what do you do with the talent that God gave you? Because the scripture shows us that everyone was given something. Hello. Five, two, and one. So everyone's given something here. You got something that God has deposited in you. The question is, what are you doing with it? Are you being productive in the kingdom of God? Are you being productive in your life concerning your Christian walk? Are you producing? Are you being productive? So then he tells them, he calls them unprofitable. Because apparently, what was given to him, he got rid of it. And that's what happens to people that get salvation in their life. One day they decide to leave the church. So they take their very valuable, precious salvation and they get rid of it. See, this world is always going to tempt us, whoever you are. It'd be nice if we could live a Christian life never being tempted. Amen? So you got to ask yourself, what do you value the most in your life? Do you value your salvation? Is it precious to you? Now, are you taking that salvation and what God has given you, and now are you producing more and more what God wants from your life? So this one person took whatever God gave him, whatever the Lord gave him, he doesn't value it. So he buries it. Didn't mean nothing to him. But the other ones knew the way their Lord was. They knew, no, I got to produce. I got to get more for my Lord. I got to do more for my Lord. What happens? They doubled it. And their Lord was happy. See, this world is always going to go after your time. One of the most precious commodities that you have is time. But one thing about time, you can regain it. I told you before, with time, you can capture time, but that's about it. You can capture it in a photo, but that's it. But you can't regain time. You can't recycle time. You can't go back 20 years from now, 20 years before, and be 20 years younger again. Even though you wish you were like that. Amen. I wish I could look in the mirror and say, man, there goes all my hair again. I'm like 30 pounds lighter. Looking smooth, my little shades on. I wish I could do that. But we can't. So the greatest thing that you have right now at your disposal is time. So now that you value time and you value your salvation, now what are you doing with these two? Are you using your time to invest in the things of the Lord and bring increase to the kingdom of heaven? Do you understand now? What do you value the most? There's people that value children. That's fine. So they invest all their time in their children, but their salvation is little by little dwindling. There's others that value money. They got to have money, 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 money. And they throw all their time into making money. And then their home falls apart. Hello. Two things you have, time and money. Didn't they have time? Because the Bible tells us that the Lord went away, but he returns. So God, his Lord, their Lord, gave them time. What are we doing with the time that we have right now? If you value your salvation and you think about, my man, I'm so glad to be saved, you would take that time and produce the goodness and the things of God in your life. But if you don't value your salvation, but all you value is time but not salvation, you're going to invest in those things that are contrary to what God wants. Because you're investing your time into something. How many know that? You know, years ago, there was an old saying, you can tell a lot about a Christian when you look at their checkbook. See, whatever you value the most, that is where you're going to invest all your time. See, to double the gift, to double the talent, it was going to take time from that servant. That servant will have to invest time and energy in the things that will bring productivity. The other guy did not value it, so he didn't care. He did not want to invest the time and the energy and the effort to increase the talent, so he decides, I'll just bury it. Very dangerous to have a mentality like that. Well, I'll just bury it. We'll be all right. See, the main points of this parable is this. God wants us to be faithful in using the opportunities for service that the Lord has given you. The Lord gave him an opportunity for service. He goes, here's your opportunity. You know who I am? Even the one guy that got the one talent knew the character of his Lord. Here you go. They all had the same opportunity. Do you know that all of us right here have the same opportunity that the next person has serving God? You have to decide what you're going to do with what God has given you. If you're a husband here and you say, you know what? My relationship with God is not where it's supposed to be. You cannot blame no one but yourself, because you've been given the same opportunity as that other husband in the church or that other man in the church. If you're a woman of God here, you can't get mad at someone else because they're producing, because you've been given the same opportunity. They just decided to invest their time in what God values the most. You understand now? What do you value the most? That's where you will spend most of your time. See, diligence in the scripture, in this story, it shows us that God will reward diligence, doesn't he? And he even says it that he's faithful and he'll reward those that are diligent. But the story also shows us the opposite of this is that if you're negligent, negligence will be punished. That's what we miss when we look at this stuff. See, whatever we have, whatever opportunities or abilities, everything that we have in life, every opportunity, your abilities you have, you're smart in areas, you excel in all these things. This is all God-given abilities. God gave you those things. We're just simply stewards of what God has given us. We can't give ourselves more time. We're just called to manage our life from day to day. You can't give life. I can't give life. Hello, somebody. It all belongs to God. And the funny thing is that God right now is far, far away. And it says that for the kingdom of heaven, in verse 14, is as a man traveling into a far country who called his own servants and delivered unto him their goods. See, the Lord grants opportunities for service. And he will give us what we can handle. He'll give you according to your ability. See, you can't say, I can't serve God. Yes, you can. Well, I can't do this. Yes, you can, because he gives us according to our ability. Hello. And we see in verse 15, unto one he gave 5 talents. Apparently that guy can handle 5 talents. To another one he said, I'll give you 2 because he can handle 2. And even with the one that didn't have much ability, he gave 1. And then straightway he left. He took his journey. See, in the day of judgment, the number of talents will not matter, church. The question is going to be to all of us, have you been faithful in your use of your talents? In other words, have you been productive in what he has given you? Because God is going to settle the accounts with people's lives. That's why I tell people, hey, don't worry about going to Lighthouse Christian Fellowship. Don't worry even be being your preacher. Hey, doesn't matter, because God's going to settle all of our accounts. How many know that? Look in verse 19. After a long time, the Lord of those servants came, and what did he do? Settle accounts. See, the day of reckoning is coming. For all of us, the day of judgment, as you're a Christian, we're still going to be judged according to our works. We know that. Because Jesus is going to come settle the accounts. That's the way he operates. We know when it comes to the story of the wise and the foolish, Jesus is in the parable of the bridegroom. And it says in verse 5, but while the bridegroom was delayed, they all slumbered and they slept. We talked about the virgins a few services ago. How they got lazy and they just slept. One of the culprits of today's church is laziness. Because it's funny, but I meet people and they're so excited to do things that they enjoy. No problem. Just like this big trip we got. Man, there's people going, God bless you. But can I see you in streets over here next week? Hello. They all slumbered and they slept. The Christian church battles with laziness, church, when it comes to the things of God. See, we're not lazy when it comes to things that we like to do that's going to benefit our life here on earth. But why is it when it comes to the things of the Lord, there's always a struggle? You ever notice that? How many like to eat pizza? Come on, man. No one likes to eat pizza? I don't want to make you hungry right now, but you don't like a good pizza? How many know it's not a struggle to get people together to eat some pizza? You ever get about 4 or 5 of you and you're eating pizza and you're still a little hungry and you're sitting at the table, maybe you're all talking, and there's 1 piece left? Why is it that you know you want to eat it, but and everybody's thinking the same thing? Do I grab it? I didn't grab it. I just grab it. See, we like those things. We have no problem. Hey, man, we're going to get a couple of giant pizzas. You got 10. I got. Right? No problem. How much is the bill? And some of you are liberal and you'll be like, oh, I got it today. Don't worry about it. I got it. Don't worry about it. But then when it comes to the things of the Lord, it's so hard. Oh, man, get that basket away from me. Hello. Because you value eating that pizza. But you have to value your salvation too. They slumbered and they slept. See, the unprofitable servant is cast into hell because of his heart condition. He never connected with his Lord. The other two did. And the evidence is that they produced. The other one waited for the Lord to leave and just got rid of it and went about living his life. And he calls him wicked and lazy. And listen to what he says in verse 25, because he's still trying to make excuses. Just be real. He just said, you know what, God, the truth of the matter is, Lord, I didn't want to do anything. I want to live my life. I want to do what I want to do. But no, look what he does. And he threw a little emotional. He got real emotional. It says, and I was afraid. So because I was afraid, I went and hid your talent in the ground. What are you afraid of? Can it be that he knew the consequences of his decision? And maybe he thought that the Lord was never going to come back. And now the reality is that the Lord is right in front of him. Can't be afraid of something if you don't know the consequence of it. And he said, and when he hid his talent in the ground. And then he says, look, there you have it. What is yours? It was never his. Do you catch that? See, what you value the most, you'll personalize it. It's mine. This is my life, my salvation. He did not personalize it at all. And that shows us that he was there when he heard the message. He was there when his Lord gave them all their talents, the money. But his money, he didn't want no part of it. He went and he just hid it. And that's why he's called the wicked servant, because there was never no connection with the Lord. It says in verse 30, and cast the unprofitable servant into outer darkness, and there'll be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Because he did nothing. See, God wants us to be productive with two important things. What does God give us with the talent? Two things are going to come with what God deposits in your life. Ability and opportunity. You can mark those on the tablets of your heart. That everyone in this place, the Lord, if you're saved, you have Jesus Christ in your life. He is depositing you ability and opportunity. Those things you have. So when you say you have nothing, you do. Ability and opportunity. So the question arises today, this morning, as I get ready to bring this to a close, is what are we doing with the ability and the opportunity that he's given us as individuals and as a church? See, we got to determine what is our talent. Because not everyone has the same talents. Some might have one, some might have five, some might have two. But the Lord will always give us according to our ability. And that's in Romans chapter 12, verses 3 and 8. And you read that. In verse 4 of Romans, he says, for as we have many members in one body, and all the members have not the same office. Verse 5. So we being many are one body in Christ, and every one members one of another. That talks about the connectivity in the church, being connected. Having then gifts, deferring according to the grace that is given to us, whether prophecy, let us prophesy according to the proportion of faith, or ministry, let us wait on our ministry, or he that teacheth on teaching, or he that exhorteth on exhortation, he that giveth, let him do it with simplicity, and he that ruleth with diligence, and he that shows mercy with cheerfulness. See, everybody has a gift. And it's given to us according to the grace of God in our life. Now, some of our abilities are obvious, or they're inherited. If you have the ability to give, maybe you inherited wealth, whatever the case may be. Some of you are in positions, came into the church, and you're in positions of influence in the secular world. You're there because of your abilities. You're a good worker. You're a good person. You excel at work. You were productive. You learned your trade. You learned your skill. And you moved up the corporate ladder. Or if you're a blue-collar worker, you moved up the ladder because you used your ability. If you're a welder and you excelled in welding, you moved up the ladder. If you were a plumber, whatever the case may be, those are inherited abilities. But then there are other abilities that are not so obvious. They are hidden. And these are the ones that when you come into the church, for example, a hidden ability, a hidden gift is teaching and preaching. I use myself for an example. When I came into the church, I never thought about preaching, or I didn't even know I could do any. I've always been afraid to stand in front of crowds. But see, that is a gift that God deposited in me. But I had to use the ability that he gave me for that gift to be productive. So now I stand here, and I stand in crowds of 1,000. Because of the hidden gift that he deposited in me. But if I never move in that direction, if I never do what God told me to do, then my gift would just lay dormant. So there are gifts that are hidden that you never knew there were gifts until you get saved and you come to church and they begin to come out of you. Hello. Okay? See, my gift I thought was playing baseball, but God said no. So there are gifts that God has placed in you that are laying dormant in you right now. And God wants those gifts to come out of you. He wants those gifts because those gifts are going to bless the church. They're going to bless the church, and those gifts will cause the church to be productive. Maybe you have a gift of putting things together. You're a great organizer. Well, the church can use that. Maybe you're a good cook. How many churches can use people that can cook? How many Christians went from one addiction to a food addiction? We went from alcohol and weed and coke to food. See, now we don't talk about, hey, man, where can I get a good bag from? Where can I get some good weed from? No, now we're talking about, did you go to that one restaurant? Listen to Christians talk. Yo, man, they got good tacos. Oh, man, but I know another place they got good. We went from one addiction to the next, right? Don't act like you don't eat. Come on now. Then some of you act like you never drank alcohol, you never smoked weed. You're a liar. Some of you still smoking weed. That's your problem. Some of you were addicted to dancing in the nightclub. Oh, Lord, here we go. Some of you are addicted to drinking. You just hung out at the bar. You never been to a bar? No one? Because if no one went to a bar, then where's all these companies getting all this money? Somebody's making them rich. So there are things in our life right now that are hidden. That as you get saved in the church, God wants those gifts to come out of you. You have something to offer. You just got to tap into what God gave you. It's like me. I hate flying. I got to shoot out to Mexico, a whole other part of Mexico in August. I'm going somewhere. I know I'm flying into San Antonio. Never been to this guy's church. I just know that I'm flying into San Antonio, and then from there, they're going to come pick me up 2 hours away, and I'm going into Mexico. Don't know nobody over there. Don't know anybody. But for the gift that God has given me, he's also given me the ability to do it. Or I can stay home. I was just telling Pastor Ruben today, Connie's not my mom. Didn't I tell you that? Connie is not my mother. Connie's my wife. Connie doesn't dress me. Dear, can you put my pants on and my tie on? I wear some things. She'd be like, you're going to wear that one? That's right. I'm styling profiling this. Well, it doesn't match. I ain't worried about all that. I like it. I ain't telling you what to wear. I ain't telling you that dress looks horrible on you. I ain't say nothing. Let me be me. See, you have a gift inside of you, but you gotta let it out. You can't be somebody else. You got to be who you are, the personality you have. God says, I want to use you. You're unique in who you are, and I can use you to bless the church. You'll be surprised some gifts that people have, they're not using them for the kingdom. But you go to their jobs, and they're great workers. They have great work ethics. Okay, then use that for the kingdom. But the problem is the thing that you value. Now, all of a sudden, they can tell you, come to work at 3 in the morning. You're there at 2:30. You stay 12 hours. You go beyond. You bring work home with you. But then when we say, we need people to come together, we have a big project at the church, no one wants to show up. Because of what you value. Hello? Lastly, you got to determine your talent. So how do we determine our talent? Through trial and error. Try different things till you finally hit the one you excel at. You know what I'm saying? Try different things in the church. Try different things. It's trial and error. I told you the story when I first got saved. I've always had an affinity for drums and the bass, but I like the big bass, the upright one. I've always pictured myself spinning that thing during a song service. But I'm not a musician. I've tried and I try and I try. I'm not gifted to be a musician. And one day Pastor Dean tells me, our pastor went on to, with the Lord. He says, Junior, you are not a drummer. He goes, that is not your gift. I didn't get mad. Because I'm still trying to find my gift. I'm trying to find, okay, what can I do? Some of you, I could tell you, I know you want to sing on the worship team, but honestly, you can't sing. You get all mad. No, man, you can't sing. Let me let you know that's not your gift. Please. I know you sing great at home and you're in the shower, but if the walls of that shower can talk, they will tell you, shut up. You got to find your gift through trial and error. So when he told me I couldn't play the drums, I was like, man. So, you know, and I used to bounce around the back chairs. Kind of remembers back then we used to sing a cappella. We didn't have all these CDs and all that stuff, all the technology. Back in the day, it was just, then we had tambourines. Remember the tambourines? Man, I used to hit that thing. Wham, wham. I can't play the drums. I'm going to play these tambourines. I drove Pastor crazy. He hit them on me. Years later, he told us, right, Connie? He goes, Gene, I got to confess my sins. I hid that thing from you. But then one day he tells me, I notice you get real excited in the back row. Because I used to jump around on the back row. What am I doing? Back and forth. I had my own back row. Leave me alone. Connie knew too. Get out the way. You'll get knocked out, girl. Let me praise my Lord. Let me praise Jesus. So what? Don't be embarrassed. I'm just, when people look at me, what you doing, preacher? Even to this day, she knows I'm going to praise the Lord. My daughter Christina inherited that from me. I'm telling you right now. Leave that girl alone. Leave her alone. I feel what she's feeling. I ain't worried if you don't like moving around. You can call it whatever you want. I call it loving Jesus. I call it being me. That's how I praise him. Don't get mad because I praise him. I ain't going to let no rock out praise me. You want to stay stiff and narrow and no movement? That's up to you. But I got to praise him because he's such a good, good, awesome God. Whoa, hold on. Let me see with this sermon here. You got to find your gift. So then one day he says, Junior, come here. I'm like, yeah, what's going on, Pastor? He says, I found the spot for you. I'm thinking, all right, he's going to give me another shot at the drums. You'll be a good song leader. Song leading? Okay. And God bless me leading songs. So you got to find what your gift is. Don't let it be the gift of gossip. Don't be like, that's my gift. No. Gossip is not a gift. Then how can you, another way of determining your ability or your talent is to the counsel of others. Now, this is very important that you listen to me. Proverbs 11:14 says this. Where no counsel is, the people fall. But in the multitude of counselors, there is safety. When it speaks of counselors, you just can't go to anybody for advice.
You better be careful.
Because the term counselor refers to, in the scripture, it refers to people that give advice and people that can provide guidance. You cannot just go to anybody in your church. I need guidance. What's wrong? I got these three knucklehead kids of mine that are acting crazy. Well, you're asking advice from a person that beats their kids. You're crazy. Advice comes from those that God has placed in positions to give guidance. So sometimes you got to go to the leader and say, like I did. And the leader came and told me, I want you to be a song leader. That's his guidance. I never felt the urge to lead songs. Never. But that's the leader. He was guiding me. He seen something in me that I didn't see for myself. Now, I could have been ignorant and mad. No, I ain't leading no songs. We ain't even got no instruments. Man, I can't sing. I ain't got no voice. But he seen something in me, and I took his advice. And to this day, I am where I'm at. If when you seek advice from people, when it comes to looking for your gift or anything in your life, you better go to the people that have experience in that area. Hello. That's what it's talking about. So when it comes to determining a gift, God will give the preacher insight in your life because he's the shepherd. And you might not see it. I might say, sister, you know what? You'd be a good organizer. Ah, but that's not what I want, Pastor Gene. I don't want to organize nothing. I just like telling people what to do, but I don't want to put in the work to do it. You got to go the wise counsel in anything in life. Amen. How many know you will not go seek financial advice from a person that's been bankrupt 5 times in a row? How many know you don't go seek marital advice for someone that their marriage is wrecked up? Why do we do that? Hello. Why do we seek advice from people that you know they can't give advice? That's just a freebie for you today. Wise counsel, that's what it says. Hello. Matter of fact, Proverbs 15:22, without counsel, purposes are disappointed. But in a multitude of counselors, they are established. You see what he says? Without counsel, purposes, nothing comes to fruition when you go to the wrong person for the wrong guidance. Got to go to the people with the experience. Hello. Like my wife, Connie, God bless her heart. She's been working with women for 38 years. You would think she knows a little something. But you want to go to Sister Knucklehead. That she just want to be up in your business. And there you go, pouring your heart. Oh, yes. 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 And she's like, yeah, yeah, yes. You're just hurting yourself. You got to go to wise counsel. And that's what it says. Without counsel, purposes are disappointed. If you never go to leadership and look for advice, trying to determine your gift, it never comes to fruition. And you just sit there doing nothing. Hello? I like this scripture. Proverbs 19:20. Again, it comes up again about the advisor. Hear counsel. Put it up there. We're going to show you. For that way you can see I'm not giving you false doctrine. Hear counsel and receive what? All together. Hear counsel and. Wow. So that means if I go to the wise counsel, I can find instruction. Because see, your counsel is wise because they're going to look at things not from a heart issue, but from a biblical perspective. They're not worried about how you feel. See, I have to tell you the truth. And sometimes the truth, yes, it hurts. But wise counsel will let you down with grace. I'm sorry, brother.
you are, we can't use you over there, man. I'm sorry, man. I'm sorry. Why, Pastor? I just, you know, can I be honest with you? Yeah. That's not your forte. Sister, I know you did your best trying to bake that cake. But somewhere along the line, you left out an important ingredient. And she says, what is that, Pastor? Taste. So we're not going to use you for the bake sale. But if you want to coordinate the bake sale, I notice you're really good with that. Wise counsel. Or you're going to go to your friend. You know I cook good, right? Or you go to your husband, son, your wife. Pastor Jesus said, that's the thing it tastes. You know it tastes good, right? And there goes your husband. Yes, dear, yes. But behind his back, he got his fingers crossed. We first got married. My wife's not in here. We first got married. My poor wife, man, she tried to cook me some food. And for a few months there, I ate it, and I didn't say nothing. And then one day she goes, honey, sometimes when I cook the meat, is it okay? I'm like, oh, God. What would I say here? We're just newlyweds. We've only been married like about 6 or 8 months. I'm like, I didn't want to hurt her feelings. I go, but then she gave me the avenue. She goes, is the meat a little dry? And back then I was like, man, girl, it's brittle. But I say, yes, it's a little dry. She goes, why were you eating it? I love you, babe. I don't want to hurt your feelings. You know, you cooked it and stuff. But since you got the door open, please don't make that noise anymore. It says, hear counsel, receive instruction, that they may be wise. And look what it says in the latter end. That talks about development and progression, right? See what happens when you listen to wise counsel and you find your gift? That gift will begin to mature. You begin to develop, and in the end, you become what God wants you to become. When you go to wise counsel. I'll leave you with this final thought. This morning, I don't know why I make people nervous. I don't know. They just get nervous. I don't know why. I don't know. Well, anyway, you know, the worship team, they're all singing their little songs. You know, they're getting down, but, I can hear, and I'm like, see, I went for training, for worship. Some of you probably never knew that. See, you don't know everything about my life. Well, I went to training for worship. They sent us to this training thing we had to go to years ago. Well, anyway, so I heard something, and I walk up, and I tell you, no lie. Julian knows it. The minute I stepped right here, they all got tense. Why? It's a mystery to me. It's a mystery. Today, and even with them, I had to let them know. Hey, I'm very direct in my instructions and my delivery because that's the way the military trained me to conduct classes and to give instruction. You have to be very direct and to the point. I'm not going to be flying the plane all around here until it didn't sound right, we got to go back here. I'm not going to be like, well, you know, it didn't sound right, let's go back over here. Let's work on it. In closing, the Lord has given you abilities. We're supposed to be prepared for His coming, but also in the duration of this time while we're waiting, He requires us to be productive. Why? Because you don't want to end up the wicked and the lazy servant. It can happen to any of us. All it takes is you just pushing in that direction more and more. More and more time for yourself. More and more time for other things that don't really have kingdom value at all. And then one day you can find yourself right out of the church. Two things God wants from us. To be prepared for His coming. but he also wants us to be productive in our life. You have ability and you have opportunity, but it's going to require that you invest the most precious thing that we like to hold on to, our time. That's what it's going to require. That's what it's going to require, your time. If you're willing to invest your time into the things of the Lord, the latter end, you're going to be blessed. So I ask you this morning, where have you been spending most of your time? And whatever you answer to yourself, that is what you value the most. I heard a man dying on his dying bed, and he tells me the greatest regret in my life was I treated my family like they didn't matter. It's too late. He's dying. It was too late for the wicked servant. This morning is not too late for us. What do you value the most? That's where you spend most of your time. Every head bow, every eye close. The Lord says, enter into the joy of the Lord. Enter into the joy. Then he even says, why were they able to enter? Because he commended them in two areas, in their actions and in their commitment. In their actions, he says, well, you did good. Well done. That's the action. Faithful is the commitment. You did good in your commitment to the Lord. And that's why they were able to enter into the rest of the Lord. Because they were committed and their actions reflected that. This morning, what do our actions reflect today? Maybe you're in this church, you came to check it out. It's not by coincidence we do this practically every service. It's not by coincidence that you end up in a Christian church. But I want to make this invitation to you. I'm not asking you to, you know, join the church. And no. I'm asking you, are you right with God right now? Jesus Christ wants to be the Lord and Savior of your life. You got to ask yourself, am I right with the Lord? Is my life connected to God, or have I been living life on my terms? And if you say, yes, Pastor, I've been living my life on my terms, but today I want to surrender to Jesus. And I want to get on His family, in His family. I want to commit my life to God this morning. I want Him to take control of my life. If that is you, just by the simple uplifting of your hand, we can pray with you. And you can have Jesus Christ in your heart today before you leave. It's up to you if you want it. Quickly, just lift your hand up and put it back down. Anybody? God bless you, brother. I see that hand. Anybody else would join our brother? I say, that's it. Committing my life to Him. No more messing around. No more. I'm going to let go and let God be the God of my life. Anybody else? It's your opportunity. I want our brother to come up, and our brother will lead you in prayer. Eric, lead him in the sinner's prayer. Please. I want the rest of the church, will you stand to your feet? Listen, you're good folks. You got to find your talent in the church. It's there. God gave it to you. Some of you, it's more than one gift, but He gave it to you. Venture out. Get involved. See, I say get involved, right? You guys think of ministry. There's a lot to do in church without ministry. Maybe your gift is connecting with people. Then use that gift. Connect with people. Maybe your gift is to fellowship with and help people out. Hey, sister, you'd like to, for all the sisters, not the men. Sister, we'd like to go have coffee tomorrow morning. And because you have that gift, you can talk and you connect. Find your place and let that gift mature. Seek counsel
from those that are over you, from wise people. Go to the right people for counsel. And if you're looking for your gift, sometimes the pastor will find it in you and say, I want you to try this. And it might be something you don't like, but later on you find out you excelled in it. I don't know where I'll be today, honestly, if I would have told Pastor Dean, I don't want to lead songs, because leading songs opened the door to teaching and preaching, and look where I'm at today. I'm not saying I can preach, I'm just telling you, man, where God led me. I just listened to the counsel. He said, I need to lead songs, son. I want you to lead the songs. He said, okay. I said, are you sure? Because I can't sing, man, but I could jump around. He goes, you know what, Junior? That's what I love about Pastor. He told me, you're different. He told me that. Even when I started to preach, I remember one time I preached at a place, and he noticed, he came to see, and he noticed something different about me. And after the service, because I watched all these great men of God preach as I was growing up, and my turn came, and I remember, I said, well, maybe I need to preach like them. The style, the delivery. And I thank God for Pastor, because after that, he called me to the side, and he goes, June, you have to be who you are. They preach like that because that's who they are. He goes, but son, you have something in you. And you gotta let God use your life, and you gotta be who you are. So I can get crazy and it's cool. He goes, yep. So I can run around and just be me. He goes, yep. He goes, that's what I love about you. And that's what God wants to use, who you are. God wants to use who you are. You can't be sister so-and-so. You can't be brother so-and-so. You can't be somebody else's husband or somebody else's wife. You got to be who you are. Amen? You got to be who you are. Use your gift. Tap into that gift. And let's start producing in the kingdom of heaven. Amen? I'm going to open the altar. God spoke to you. Why don't you come? Just seal that thing with God. Say, you know what, God? I'm going to be what you call me to be. I'm going to be the man and the woman that you designated me to be, God. Or you come and praise it. God, help me find my gift. God, bring it to the surface, God. Help me to see what you want from my life, Lord, as a Christian person, a Christian man, Christian woman. Praise you, Jesus. Glory, 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 glory. Glory, glory, glory. Have your way, God.